I didn't quite realize how big this market and problem is. I'm still, my eyes are being open to it. So this is not just about, and mental health has so many aspects to it, and it touches on addiction. So I'm glad that we're sort of moving in this direction and working with hopefully we can make investments or just be supportive, just as we're trying to do with the on the philanthropic impact side. So Joe, do you want to tee it up?
Yeah, sure. And thanks, Mark. It's been really an interesting space to kind of learn about. I mean, got to know MJ over the past probably 6 to 9 months, having met him in like a professional self-development course, and kind of really expanded upon what he was doing within the addiction recovery space, and just found it so eye-opening that, it impacts 300 million people worldwide. It's a $42 billion industry globally.
300 million alcohol alone.
300 million alcohol alone, exactly. And then when you include drugs and other narcotics as well, and other kinds of addictions, that number is obviously exacerbated even further. And I kind of just saw what MJ was doing and kind of recognized that it was super impactful. It touches people's lives as you kind of talk to either different families, investors, family offices, it impacts so many people in ways that, I think MJ, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's like 1 in 10 people suffer from some kind of, or are related to some kind of addiction, in their family. And so we thought it'd be really helpful to kind of just walk through this deep dive with folks from the Heron Project. So that was founded by Chris Heron, which is a former NBA basketball player who suffered from heroin addiction. We're joined by Kevin. Kevin, I'm going to butcher your last name. So
Lasik.
Thank you. And then we've got folks from Rock to Recovery, which was founded by Wes Geer, former guitarist from the band Korn. So they're going to kind of be stepping in and kind of filling us in on how they utilize music as a way to really, help influence and transform lives. And so obviously we'd love to kind of keep this, discussion interactive so people have questions, but I'm going to kind of allow MJ, given his experience in the space, love for everybody to kind of go through a little bit of background, but kind of MJ really, be the moderator here and really kind of, run this discussion and dialogue. It's your area of expertise. So I'll kind of kick it over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Joe. And yeah, 1 in 3 families are impacted by substance abuse disorder. So it's quite, I think we all know, I don't think there's anybody that I've met who hasn't had a friend, a family member who's been impacted by alcoholism or addiction. And there's also tremendous economic loss, $1.45 trillion in economic loss. So I think that, as you all know, we've been discussing the importance of mental health specifically now with COVID, right? And what I wanted to do is I wanted to bring in two unbelievable foundations that are on the front lines of treatment so you can kind of hear what they do. And as you know, I was... the challenges that we have is that people have stigmas of addiction, right? They think it's a lack of willpower. What am I doing wrong? When in fact, it's a genetic bullet. And once they understand that it's a treatable medical disease, it completely changes the dynamic. There's shame, which prevents so many people from getting the help they need. And then very sadly, the outside community, when they get interviewed and they say, would you support mental health? They say 100%. But would you support addiction? They're like, absolutely not. Not understanding that it falls within the same thing. And then the third, which is that sobriety is the end of fun, right? And you'll hear what Wes is doing as an example to kind of it lead the whole kind of movement on showing how frickin' cool sobriety is and the amazing things that Kevin and Chris from Heron are doing from placing people in the right treatment and giving them aftercare. There's all a ton of other stuff that Wes and Kevin and their programs are doing. So I felt that it would be fantastic to bring them on, show you what they're doing, and we need to throw our full weight behind this, the addiction and non-addiction community. There's a saying, those amongst us, no explanation is necessary. Those not amongst us, no explanation is possible. And so it's not your fault that you don't understand the challenges that exist within the addiction community. And if you look at what's going on with COVID, people that were having two drinks pre-COVID are now having two bottles of wine and seven Xanax and wondering and jumping into our groups and sober curious groups wondering what in the world is happening. Do I have a problem? And it gives them a forum to ask questions, which is something that I wish I had when I was getting sober. It's called this whole sober curious movement, right? So what I'd like to do now, Chris had a conflict at the last moment, but the executive director, Kevin Mikolajczyk, did I get that right, Kev?
Mikolajczyk, close. That was a pretty good.
Mikolajczyk is the executive director, and actually helped Chris on his journey to sobriety. So I'd like to have Kevin talk for about 10, 15 minutes, and then turn it over to Wes and Dr. Sharp to talk about, Rock to Recovery. And then we can kind of talk about the stigmas and the challenges and the biggest problems that we have and, what needs to be addressed. So Kevin Mikolajczyk, executive director of the Heron Project.
Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank you for taking the time to listen to us and to hopefully gain a better understanding of recovery and addiction in general and the challenges that we face. I've been blessed with the gift of long-term recovery now for almost 17 years, and it's been an unbelievable blessing in my life. And I think kind of what that means for me, and I hear MJ talk about this a lot, kind of the opposite of addiction is connection. And I've been blessed with some unbelievable connections that have guided me and walked with me on my journey to recovery. And I think, one thing we've learned from COVID is that that connection is critical. And when that is taken away, people struggle. And we've adapted as an organization pretty quickly in the beginning of the pandemic by, switching online recovery meetings to Zoom. So we offer 7 nights per week. And it's an opportunity for people to connect and still be around like-minded individuals and hear stories of hope and recover. And, I think we have seen too that, and I think MJ had touched on this a little bit, that, during this pandemic, the problem has drastically increased, not just for people, like he said, that, have upped their drinking and, potentially misuse of prescriptions, but also people in recovery really struggling without that connection, without work. And, so the challenge for us is even greater right now. So I commend you all for, taking this time and listening and gaining a deeper understanding. So I'll go into a little bit about what Heron Project does. Chris was a former NBA basketball player. He lost his whole career to addiction. And in 2008, he was given the gift of recovery by Liz and Chris Mullen. Chris Mullen was part of the NBA Dream Team, had a long and storied career in the NBA, and he is also in recovery. But they gave him an opportunity to recover. And when at the time in Chris's life, he had nothing. Most people had given up on him, and he didn't have any opportunities. And the state-run facilities didn't have availability, so there was a lot of issues facing Chris in that moment, and the Mullins stepped in and gave him a gift. So in 2011, Chris saw that need to assist individuals and families with that help, and it really started, with a goal of really just assisting one person, one family at a time. And over the last almost 10 years, it's really grown into a movement, and we've helped thousands of individuals and families all across this country. So we kind of work in 3 key areas. The first area is with the individuals. And what you'll notice is even when someone is ready to ask for help, You know, there are tons of hurdles in their way. You know, a lot of people don't have the resources to self-pay for treatment. A lot of people are underinsured, and a lot simply just don't have insurance. And that's where we come in. We have a team of recovery coaches and clinicians that work with individuals. So we get phone calls from people all across the country. And our goal is really to walk on the journey to recovery with those people. There's, you know, like SAMHSA, for example, has an 800 number. You can call them, you kind of tell them what's going on, what your zip code is, and they're going to generate a list of facilities that are in your area. That does little to nothing for someone that doesn't know how to navigate the system, that has no resources, that is underinsured. So our team walks with those individuals, we work with them, and it's a high touch hand holding process. So we're not just giving them a list of places to call. We're walking with them through this. We're connecting the dots, we're crossing the T's to make sure that they get the help they need regardless of their financial situation or their insurance situation. And we have a network of providers that we work with that are trusted, that have been unbelievable to us and our clients with in-kind donations. We also have a budget from our own donations in which we can actually step in and make sure that that person gets help using our resources. Once we place them, we walk with them. We work with the treatment center to ensure they have proper aftercare set up. And then once they transition out of treatment, we continue walking with them on their journey through recovery housing scholarships and recovery coaching. So we're really not just, you know, giving someone a list of places to call. We're walking with them through the whole process. The second kind of area that we focus on is family supports. And what you'll notice is, I'm not sure on the numbers MJ gave you, but for every one person that struggles, there's probably 3 to 5 people that are close to them that also struggle with this. And we found that unless we're walking with the family on their journey to recovery too, we're doing the situation no good. So we have a team of clinicians. We offer 15-minute consultations to anyone. They can call up and get best practices, learn how to best support their loved one to recovery, and really kind of just troubleshoot the whole situation and give them a proactive approach of how to best help their loved ones. We also currently offer 18 family support groups per week. Those are all led by licensed clinicians. And we have a great community of people from all across the country. And we even have a few international people that will join these support groups via Zoom and get a psychoed component to it, and then also a mutual support. And those groups have been extremely successful. And you know, one of the things we've seen with COVID is that the need and the demand for those groups has drastically increased. So really our goal is to kind of walk with the individual, walk with the family. They need to be recovering on kind of parallel tracks, but we've found that when we can support both the individual and the families, our outcomes are that much better. And then kind of the final area we work in is prevention and wellness. And, you know, I think, you know, we can all agree that we're always going to need treatment beds. We're always going to need, you know, medication-assisted treatment. That part is not going to go away. But I think where we can make a real difference, and it's an area that Chris excels in and is really focused on through some of his other businesses, is getting in front of kids. You know, so we have what's called Heron Project Clubs. We have just about 200 schools all over the country that are participating. We're shooting to get into every state in the country. And the club is a safe space for kids. And it takes a, you know, an administrator to kind of also be part of it to get it going. But it's a safe space for kids to come together, to learn how to make healthy decisions, to be supportive to one another, to learn good decision-making, to learn stress management and other techniques to deal with stress and the other issues that they face as students. And, you know, we've received thousands and thousands of emails from kids all across the United States. And what you'll see is the data is pretty clear that, you know, ultimately it's the underlying issues that eventually will cause kids to turn to you know, alcohol, drugs, or other risky behaviors. So the goal there is to try to give kids proactive ways to deal with those underlying issues so they're safe and supportive and their overall mental well-being is intact. You know, kids struggle with anything from cutting to self-harm to, you know, they might have a family member at home that's struggling, a mom or a dad, you know, and then you put in the stress of school and everything else, and it's a recipe for a mental health crisis. So our goal really there is to walk with students and provide them an opportunity to be healthy and supported. So those are kind of the three areas that we focus in. We also have Team Heron Project, which is a group of individuals all across this country who support our mission and our goals by participating in various athletic events. We do everything from the Boston Marathon to the New York City Marathon. We're also international with that. We do the London Marathon next year, God willing, Berlin. So we have an unbelievable community of active members of recovery, family members that fundraise for us and support the great work that we do. And I think for me, everything that we try to do is about creating connections. And I know what Wesley does at Rock to Recovery, it's about creating those connections. What MJ has developed with Lucid is about creating connections. And I think one thing we've learned from COVID is we have to be more creative and find new and innovative ways to create those connections. And I think Lucid has done a great job with their platform in providing a safe space that is supportive, but also you have access to tools that can support you in your recovery. And if you're struggling, you know, there's ways that you can reach out and get help. And, you know, we need to be able to support people where they're at in the moment and provide fast access to help. So that kind of does it for Heron Project. I'm excited to hear from Wesley. I love what they do as an organization, but I'm happy to answer any questions after that. So thank you. I think you're on mute, MJ. Yep.
You hear me now. Kevin, thanks so much. If you guys think about it, before I introduce Wes, so 300 million people, alcohol alone, right? We can't open up enough treatment centers, you know, to deal with that. And so when you look at what organizations like Heron Project and Rock to Recovery do, we have to change the way people think about addiction, you know, through these stigmas, right? Because we simply cannot open enough treatment centers in the world. If people understand it's not their fault, it's just like if you have diabetes, you can't eat as much sugar and you need to give yourself maybe an insulin shot, right? People need to understand, you know, that it, you know, kill that shame. All this stuff, they need to know that they can get to the other side and they need to know how freaking cool it is to be sober. So a lot of other things that we'll talk about on the other side of this, where we can get other, you know, we can get big pharma involved and a lot of large organizations to really try to kind of help move the needle. But this is an issue that's going to continue to exacerbate. And as Kevin mentioned, you know, with COVID, it's to the thousandth power, right? So next is Wes Gear from Rock to Recovery, and Wes is doing some unbelievable things, and I don't want to kind of butcher you know, all the things that he does. There's a lot of stuff that has to do with music, a lot of stuff of meditation and breath work, PTSD work, all this amazing stuff. But again, someone who is, you know, was in active addiction like myself, like Kevin, made ourselves to the other side, right? And I was talking to Wes the other day, and kind of one of the biggest pulls that I had to Rock to Recovery was to show people how cool it is to be sober. Because if they think if this is some scarlet A, then people are never gonna get sober. So when I was speaking to Wes, he was like, that's what it's all about. And then there's a certain way that Wes and his organization explains to people how cool it is, to be sober. So I want to give it to Wes, if you can share, and then Dr. Scharf, for about an aggregate of maybe 15 minutes or so, and talk about what you're doing. So Wes Geer from Rock to Recovery.
Thanks, MJ. And Kevin, thanks for that. And everybody online and here, thanks for your time and your willingness to want to hear about this stuff. Thanks for providing all the statistical information. I'll come at you guys from you men and women from a little bit of the angle of my story. I got a record deal on piles of methamphetamine and horrible addiction, and I was masterminding a band. So there was a while when I believed that, drugs were the magic thing. And I think a lot of our world, we see that when we lose successful athletes and actors and whatever, you can have success and still be killing yourself at the same time. And I think it's really important to be saying that. And I'm sure you see it in the realm of high finance, et cetera. So I crashed and burned and ended up in a rehab, thank God. And I really didn't understand anything about my addiction. And luckily in that treatment center, they showed me some key elements of what addiction is, how it works. And yes, there's underlying emotional issues, but this allergy I have where if I put anything in my body whatsoever, I cannot use safely one sip of beer, one hit of weed, and I'm probably going to lose control. So there's important things I was taught. So that's important to say about what makes this kind of alcoholic addict that I am. And there's millions of us out there. But the issue was on my path of recovery, they have us doing things that we hear about today as the realm and modalities we use in treatment has grown and changed. As you can imagine, the early days of AA, you might see in a movie of just people in a church basement smoking cigarettes. Now we have very in-depth treatment centers doing all sorts of stuff, all sorts of different modalities and therapies. The one I was in, we did some yoga. The guys goof around and didn't really pay much attention, and we were drawing some pictures, and here I am, this musician, basically still out of my head, but I noticed that, like, why is there not music in treatment? And I think if any of you asked yourselves and kind of pause and take a second to think about how magic is music, how much it can make us emote. Look at TikTok. Without music, TikTok is nothing. You know what I mean? So what's TikTok getting everybody to do? Dance. And they're getting in their bodies. And so for me, there's this what I was witnessing in my life is this incredible untapped resource of music not put into treatment. So after I got sober and thinking my music career was over, only because I did get sober did the band Korn want me to come play guitar with them. Their guitar player had left due to addiction. Himself and a bunch of other factors I won't comment on. And so I got to tour around the world totally sober. I had my recovery. I was taught a way to stay sober. A lot of people think, and I thought for sure, well, if you were an alcoholic, drug addict, touring musician, you can't go back to that lifestyle. It's going to be deadly. But as a testament to what we know now about addiction, its treatment and recovery, you can get yourself recovered enough and be safe enough to go back in whatever world you're in. And I could tour at the highest level with Korn and stay totally sober. So it's an important testament that this stuff does work. And then when that gig was coming to an end, I was really lost for direction, and I was circling back to my time being in rehab and I was getting into meditation. I was like, all right, universe. Basically, I was miserable, you guys. I was a rock star. I lost my job. I had almost no schooling. What the F am I going to do now? So I went back into my spiritual practices, and it came to me when I asked the universe, how can I help people and make a living? And that's where the idea of Rock to Recovery came from, when I had this idea to endeavor to get music into treatment facilities, into residential treatment centers, into treatment programs. So I had this idea that I wanted to write songs with non-musicians. I want to get non-musicians in their body, in the creative process, and as Kevin and MJ have spoken about, connecting. And so I came up with this way where I could walk into a treatment center and in an hour take 10 guys who were just shooting dope a week ago who'd never touched an instrument. And by the end of the hour, they're all up singing, dancing, singing a song about whatever it was like to live their life as a drug addict and getting into the elements of hope and singing. So if you can imagine in the treatment center, what was happening is in a lot of treatment is talking about your feelings and your emotions, and you have to really confront a lot of stuff. And men and women alike are shut down. They're closed off. They're not ready to talk. But when somebody can come in and share, hey, I was just like you. I was in a treatment center. I know what it's like. You do a song. You have this great elixir. You have this that cracks you open, which is the creative process, talking, connecting, and playing the music, right? Everybody starts opening up. The therapists walk by and they're like, how did you get Jim up dancing and singing? He doesn't talk to anybody. Because there's a magic power that music has. And that's really what we've been endeavoring to do. So I started out doing it on my own. Fast forward, and we now have, I think, 13. We're adding some more staff right now as we speak, maybe 15 program administrators. We've worked with well over 200 treatment centers by now because of the model of the treatment industry. A lot of them go out of business for whatever reasons. But we now perform over 500 sessions every month. And how we work is we're integrated into the weekly treatment curriculum of treatment programs. So if you're in a residential treatment center and you're, you know, you got to talk to your therapist, you do yoga, Rock to Recovery is there. We're getting them into the creative process, teaching them how to express their emotions, get in their body. And what we find is like, And Dr. Scharf will comment more on some of the clinical efficacies of what happens. But, you know, the way I break it down in layman's terms is when we come into a treatment center, we have, like MJ says, shame and guilt and our lives are destroyed. You don't go to a treatment on a winning streak. Let me tell you that. You know what I mean? You don't win the Super Bowl and get $5 million and get married and go, hey, I think it's time for to hit treatment. You're crushed by the time you're even willing to go in there. And what we help do is crack them open and get them down to that childhood, that childlike playful spirit that many have forgot even exists in them, and then get to integrate that with other people. And as a result, we now have a contract. Again, we started in, you know, I'm a drug addict and a sober musician. We started in that arena with mental health and addiction. But since then, because of our success, we have a contract with the Department of Defense working with Wounded Warriors now internationally. We've been at the VA in Brentwood every Thursday. And so we know we all hear, I think most people on this chat have heard that we lose 22 veterans a day. It's probably much more than that. But what we're finding is that this program has been really, really effective in creating a mechanism in which veterans can come, have a purpose, connect, express, and stay in the mix. Because that's really a big part of why we lose so many veterans. They can't, you know, do their work anymore, and they go back to their small town. They miss their brothers and sisters that was their family in the service. And then they have all these other issues, mental health, addiction, you know, physical injuries, and PTSD, emotional injuries, etc. So this has really been, we've plugged into many different arenas, not just addiction and mental health. I know we're primarily talking about addiction here. Addiction hits the veteran population in a big, big way, but we're finding that this thing that we're doing really is very effective in almost any setting we've put it in. So not Rock to Recovery as a nonprofit endeavored to increase its fundraising. I wanted to have an event, and being a musician, I wanted to have a rock concert. And one of the things I kind of stumbled into was, how do we move tickets? Well, I came up with this idea, maybe we could sell the tickets to the local treatment centers. And that was kind of, you know, it was a little bit of dumb luck, to be honest. And what happens is we have, in our events, we honor a sober rock star. So we have people like Mike Ness, who's the singer of Social Distortion. He's a punk rock guy. And he's, you know, I was shooting dope. And until I quit dope, there would, you know, without quitting dope, there would never be a social distortion, you know? And so if you can imagine, we've got 1300 people in a sold out show, about, you know, 60, 70% of them were just in active addiction a week or two ago, thinking their life was over as they come into treatment. They get bussed into our event going, wait, I'm supposed to be sober and you're taking me to a rock concert. And then you have Mike Ness or Moby or Corey Taylor from Slipknot. We had Katie Sagal from Married with Children telling their story of how, like, yeah, I used to be a junkie or an alcoholic like you, and I get sober, and now this is my success as a result. And then they perform. We had Kings of Chaos, which is the guys from, you know, Guns N' Roses and Stone Temple Pilots, et cetera, on our stage. And it's a really incredible sober event. We've moved it to Austin. We had a great success there. And it's really something we want to brand as we grow around the country, as MJ is saying, to show that your life is definitely not over when you get sober. But not only that, I think another important thing to mention is there's, you know, if you think of the AA model, it's anonymous, which I'll just tell you, I'm a 12-step guy. But, and for good reason, we keep people safe and anonymous in those rooms. But if you could think about that thick wall and partition where people are hiding and like, I'm a sober person, I'm going to go hide and get my recovery over here. And this whole other world we're talking about that doesn't really know much about why Uncle Dan is vomiting blood and been drinking for 40 years and doesn't know what to do with it. We've got to start breaking down those walls and really coming together as a community. And then at our events, you'll see people who aren't sober, like Jamie Presley, who's won an Emmy, come out in support of recovery in these events. And that's another beautiful aspect of what's happening in these Rock Recovery concerts we're doing, is to really build a community and break down the walls between sober and not sober. So I think that's good for me. Thank you for listening, everybody out there. Hopefully I haven't put you to sleep. MJ, thank you. And passing over to Dr. Sharf, I guess.
That was awesome. Thanks, Wes. Yes, handing the mic to Dr. Constance Sharf from Rock to Recovery.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having us this morning or afternoon, wherever you may be. I am so grateful to get the opportunity to speak with you and to talk about Rock to Recovery. Like the other gentlemen who've spoken, I too am in recovery. I've been sober for over 22 years. When I was in my early 20s, I was dying. My liver and kidneys were so distended, you could see them through my skin. And my family had a little bit of money, and so they were not going to let me go to jail. They were not going to let me go to an institution. I was just going to drink myself to death. And fortunately, I found recovery. And I'm now a researcher in the addiction and mental health field. And I came to Rock to Recovery. I was working at a high-end treatment facility in Malibu. I was the director of research. I traveled all around the world looking at different research modalities for complementary and alternative medicine. And I was invited to a Rock to Recovery session. And when I saw it, I was like, this is where I want to move the focus of my research. And you know when you have a bad day. See, music affects anyone with a brain, and I don't mean that in any sort of sarcastic or facetious way. Literally, our brains respond to music. They're wired to respond to music. And you know this, if you've had a bad day and you're driving home and a song you love comes on the radio and you sing along to it, you feel better. And that's the neurological mechanism that we exploit in Rock to Recovery. And what made me so interested in Rock to Recovery is that when I saw the session, I couldn't believe that non-musicians who were in detox, so we had no one with more than 1 week in recovery, were able to write and record a song in an hour. That blew me away. But what really made me want to move over and work with Rock to Recovery is that within the next day, I was giving a presentation to patients at the facility, and they were so proud of what they did. They were sharing their songs. with each other. And I couldn't remember the last time I saw someone in early recovery who was proud of something that they did, who wanted to share something that they did, were connecting with others in their community. Because usually in rehab, everybody hates each other. If I have to hear you talk about your mother, brother, girlfriend, child doing whatever is irritating you one more time, because they go from process group to process group, Rock to Recovery gives us an opportunity to bring those feelings to the fore and relate to each other in a very connected way. And within a year, I had left that treatment facility and was with Rock to Recovery because it really is so powerful. I think what's important is understanding that there are different groups of people that we clump together as mentally ill and addicted. And what we find is that there are similar ways of approaching them. And so what, you know, Kevin's talking about where we can work with youth, what Wes is talking about where we can work with veterans. We use these modalities that we've come to through research into addiction treatment to help neurologically, because the neurological problems are the same. What we see developing in youth is that there's a beginning of a feedback loop. This is the science behind it. That the problem with addiction is not actually the substance. If I removed you from the substance, you should get better. Invariably, those with addiction problems get worse. Those first few weeks, months after the initial detoxification from whatever substance they're abusing, the person gets more squirrely, more antsy, more difficult to deal with. And so we know that the problem is something else. And what we found is that it's neurological. I think about drinking. Right. When I'm using, I think about drinking all the time. I've got to get it. I've got to get it. How am I going to use it? Then I use it, reinforces that thought process. And then immediately I start thinking about how I'm going to use again. And so what we do with music, with breath work, with meditation, with other complementary therapies is we break that feedback loop and we interrupt it and get someone moving in a different direction. And that's what these complementary therapies do. The other beauty of complementary therapies is that once I teach you how to use them, you can use them in the rest of your life. So if someone teaches you how to use yogic breathing, which is what breathwork is, if someone teaches you how to write a song, if someone teaches you how to meditate, then those are tools that you can take out into your life and use them to maintain your recovery. So we're very big on giving people the opportunity to have long-term sobriety without being dependent on a system that, quite frankly, is very expensive. The other thing that I think is important to understand is that people who are not addicts, people who are not substance abusers, don't understand why addicts and alcoholics hurt the people around them. And it isn't because we want to. It's because the people around us get in the way of our using. So for example, if I was using and you invite me to your wedding, right? I want to show up. Now you and I both want me to show up sober, but if I'm using, that cannot happen. I'm not capable of it. So I might show up a little bit loaded. I might show up a lot loaded. I might make a scene. I might not. But if you intervene in that, right, if you get in the way of that, then the problem of it escalating becomes greater. So theft is the same thing. If I need to use and you don't just hand over the money that I need, I have some limited choices. There's prostitution, there's theft. That's kind of it, right? If I don't have any money. And so, yeah, I'm gonna steal your stuff and I'm gonna pawn it because it's easier than working the street. We have a misunderstanding about addiction that because you don't have that with cancer, you don't have that with diabetes. People who have those illnesses don't get in the way of their getting better. And so an addict believes that the only way they can get better is to keep using because I get sick when I don't use. And so that is part of the stigma that we have to overcome is to understand that the addict is a good person underneath, usually a good person underneath there, and they behave badly because of the addiction. If we can get them treatment, that behavior goes away. And that's how we rebuild families. So those are just some of the scientific things behind addiction and recovery. If you have other questions, Wes and Kevin and I would be happy to answer them.
Thanks so much, Dr. Scharf. I want to introduce two other gentlemen. But before they do that, Tom jumped in, pun intended, saying powerful, purposeful stuff. How can this group take action that matters? So I want to kind of circle back around to that, you know, after I want to introduce Nash that owns two treatment facilities, Apex Wellness, which is Chapel Hill and Intrepid down in Florida, as well as Jake Bresky, who's the head of admissions. They're doing some amazing things. And, you know, Nash, let me ask you, you know, with regard to people coming in, shame, this is going to be the end of fun. Like, what do you see happening within people that come into your detox centers and residential treatment?
Well, thanks for the introduction, MJ. Constance, Kevin, Wes, you guys have all said stuff that I could talk to you guys for hours. I just kind of want to vibe with you about a couple of things. But there's a lot of shame. There's a lot of misconceptions that are involved with it. And honestly, everybody really covered it very well. What Wes said about getting Billy to stand up and actually say some things about his family, those are the moments that we kind of live for. And at the levels of care that we offer, which is detox and res, we get those clients that come in and they were using yesterday. And they're banged up, you know, and when they kind of come around, we treat them medically and they can kind of come around and we offer 40 clinical hours a week. And at that time, we tend to see the about face that people really kind of open their eyes and begin to think about, the life that's available to them. But yeah, a lot of times I've been sober for 10 years and I got sober when I was 24. And it was, what am I going to do now? You know, like, what am I supposed to do? And then even today I get invited to, you know, a new neighbor moves in. He says, why don't you come over and have a beer? And I'm like, yeah, sure. And I just think to myself, I'll just have, you know, a Red Bull when I go over there and hang out. But yeah, it is a concern. What I found was the fellowship was the main thing that I was able to get into, that took away that concern of not having a social life anymore. So it's stuff like the Lucid app that's going to empower people to get sober and stay sober. Because these are the things that people need, you know, like I said, and then you've got Kevin talking about the adolescent portion of this. That was my concern when I was 24. What am I going to do now? How am I going to socialize? How am I going to have a life where, what am I going to go bowling and be in bed by 9 o'clock at night, which is coincidentally my life today after some sobriety. But, and that's fine. But at first I needed to be around some other young men and, you know, that wanted to be sober and wanted to have fun. And that in itself was a relief. And that was such a relief to not be worried about the cycle that Constance was talking about is I need to get my fix. And then when you get your fix and I need to figure out how to get money to get my fix. And then I get it. Now it's just a cycle and it's over and over again. Just the relief from that was enough to really, have a good life. Perfect. Not sure if it answers your question, MJ.
But. It definitely does. Jake, you want to pop in or are you good?
Yeah, sure. So I know that for me, on my end, and again, it's an honor to be here. Thank you guys for having us. But for me, on my end, dealing with admissions, I am seeing firsthand how many, and I don't like to say excuses, but how much resistance people have towards making that step to getting treatment. And the biggest concern that most people have is that once you reach that path and you reach that point in your addiction where you're physically dependent on whatever substance it may be, whether it's alcohol, heroin, Xanax, whatever that substance is, your body craves it, and you will literally feel sick when you don't have it. And I know that the main thing I'm hearing is that people are afraid to enter into a treatment level of care or get help because they don't want to have to experience those withdrawal symptoms.
And they don't know that the help is available. It's crazy to us to hear that they don't even know that it's available, which is part of the what makes the work that Wes, Constance, and Kevin are doing so important, because we talk to so many people. They're like, what do you mean I can go somewhere and they're going to help me get off this stuff? They don't even know.
Yeah, and you can – the whole point of a detox level of care is to give that separation and let people know that they can – they don't have to experience those withdrawals on the level that they would if they were doing it on the couch at their friend's house. Mm-hmm. These withdrawal symptoms can literally be fatal. You can have a seizure and die from withdrawals from alcohol or benzodiazepines. And with the medical team, along with the clinicians and the whole combination of it all, you're able to comfortably and safely detox. And I had no idea that was available to me when I was 22 years old. Had I known, I would have reached out a lot sooner. And it really blows my mind how many people had no idea that there are facilities out there that are specifically designed to help you with that.
Yeah, that's a great point. You know, we have, sadly, so on Lucid, a large portion of our messages are people, just to what Jake is saying, either they're ashamed, you know, to get treatment because they think there's something the matter with them, or they just don't think that sobriety is possible. There's at least 300 to 400 messages a day. I stop at around 10:30 at night from working, and then I kind of jump into the groups and hotlines and see all these conversations going on where people say they got no chance, right? And there's at least 300 to 400 comments that I'll see a day from people that just talk about shame and why can't I control? Why can't I do this in moderation? And they just don't know. And then, you know, directing them to a treatment center. And you know, what Kevin and the Heron Project does, you know, is there, you know, and what Wes was talking about is we're talking about something that's called full spectrum care, right? So full spectrum care is you're going from detox to inpatient to IOP, which is intensive outpatient, to sober living. And then, you know, that's like full spectrum, right? But what happens next? And that's really what we created Lucid for, because we want to be able to take people from addiction to recovery to sobriety to one day at a time, give them something to do for the rest of their life and give them a life path, right? That's why we got so aggressive in building a comprehensive community, because we, you know, it was very expensive to build the comprehensive nature of the app. But if I were to say, okay, I'm going to leave this group out, I'm going to leave sober travel, sober events, or sober groups out, or sober dating, we want to be able to give people a true full spectrum and track their sobriety, and where they get jammed up, we can put in solutions. And that's why we need to work together with companies like Heron, with companies like Rock to Recovery, because these people are on and with Apex Wellness, these people are on selectively because they are on the front lines of addiction treatment. They roll up their sleeves and they are on the front lines. And that's the type of cats that I need to surround myself with, because if there's, going back to Tom Jump's question, he had to jump out, you know, what can we do, right? So I'd like to kind of pose it to Wes and Kevin. You know, first of all, the three stigmas of addiction that we've defined, the three of the biggest stigmas of addiction, there's a lot, you know, is number one, that it's a lack of willpower. That's what I thought. Why can't I just have 5 drinks? You know, what's the matter with me? My friend used to say, MJ, you know, like, why can't you just shut it down after a couple lines and five beers. I've never had five beers or five drinks in my life. The shame, we need to kill that, right? And then the whole sobriety is the end of fun thing. And so what we're asking people to do is to put up their three fingers, to stand in solidarity, to support these stigmas of addiction, right? And then to go in and donate to Heron Project and to Rock to Recovery. You donate to Lucidap Foundation, and Heron Project and Rock to Recovery are the two partners we picked. And as I said, for very good reason. So, you know, if I pose it to Kevin and Wes and Dr. Scharf, you know, what can we do? What are the, to take Tom Jump's question, and what can this group do? See, this group here in 361 and what they've created, these people, you know, surrounding us care about serving a greater good, right? And Mark and Joe and 361 are leading, you know, the front on this, right? And so they want to know, you know, what we can do, what they can do, right, in order to help move the needle. There's tremendous people in this room, but they need our help in order to really kind of explain the biggest challenges that exist and how we can really, you know, how they can throw their weight behind it so we can work together, because it's a big problem and it's going to take all of us in order to move the needle. So maybe I'll ask either Kevin or Wes or Dr. Scharf can jump in, and then certainly, you know, Jake and Nash as well. So maybe Wes, your thoughts?
Well, Wes is unmuting himself. I would love to jump in and answer that question. Yeah, and you know, what we're working in is a system that really has very little access to care. People are, even with good insurance, are very often getting kicked out of treatment at residential treatment at 17 to 19 days. We are not seeing people being able to get a full 28 or 30 day program. What we've known in the research for more than 40 years is that people actually need 90 to 100 days of treatment if they have a significant addiction problem, with a full year of support to really have a good chance at recovery. Our system does not support that. So what you see are a bunch of nonprofits, like the Heron Foundation, like Rock to Recovery, that come in to fill that access gap. And what we have is, because some of our facilities take insurance, most of the people that we work, you know, a lot of people who have a substance abuse problem, by the time they get to the willingness to go to treatment, don't have any money left, if they had any to begin with. So you see a lot of people who have, the problem is access. There are always beds available if you're going to pay $60,000 to $100,000 a month for residential care. Those beds are there. That's not the problem. The problem is in the mid-range, where people are relying on insurance, or at the low end of nonprofit facilities that are begging for services. We provide our services to 20% of our groups for free. And so we rely on fundraising. And so what people can do is, number one, have the conversation of, there's nothing wrong with talking about addiction. People like, you're sober? People are blown away when I'm speaking to the United Nations about, you know, what I do in research. They're like, how can that be? I'm like, well, because we're just people who have a problem, usually an underlying disorder that has to do with trauma. And so what we do is try to provide those services. So number one is having the conversation. And number two, either pushing to change the system, or in the meantime, funding resources that allow people to have access to care. Those are my main suggestions to anyone that I work with.
Thank you so much. I wanted, Rob had a question, and there's some other people that have some questions. Rob? It's all you.
Thanks. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, MJ? Man.
Okay. Yep. Great. This is a little bit more of a clarifying question, I suppose. A couple thoughts. One is, over the last couple of years, there's been a lot in business and in contingencies on opioid addiction. I was curious as to what extent some of these programs are treating that area, because that's one that I guess there was unknown side effects. Also, for various reasons, there's some commercial aspects in the litigation going on around settlements around opioid and pharma. And then secondly, with respect to the military, I think I saw Jerry on here. He was a former naval officer. What percentage are you all seeing on the military side? And I'm thinking about that. That's driven from different sorts of trauma, what they saw in the war or a blast that might be by them that stays with them. You know, that's a different area of stress and reaction. So that could be helpful for, you know, the audience here and, you know, frankly, ideas with respect to, you know, to funding or other type programs. That's two thoughts, MJ.
Thanks, Rob. Maybe I'll have Kevin answer the opioid and Wes, answer the other since he deals with a lot of, the vets and, you know, stuff like that. Kevin, with regard to the opioid crisis and Rob's question.
Absolutely. It was a great question. I mean, if you look at the numbers, I think it was 72,000 people last year died from an opiate overdose. When you factor in alcohol and other drugs, it's close, I believe it's over 150,000 people per year dying. So while a tremendous amount of focus has gone on the opioid epidemic, it is kind of the hot topic right now. There is still tremendous need for other drugs of abuse, alcohol, cocaine, I think you're seeing those numbers tick up across the board. You know, and it's, I think, you know, Constance had kind of talked about it a little bit, but the access to treatment and the length of care, you know, I'll go out on a limb here and I think we'll all agree the current system is broken. There needs to be a tremendous amount of change, and I think that has to start from the top down, from the federal government down. But, you know, there are opportunities for, you know, good nonprofits to really make a difference and help people through this crisis. And, you know, I think that's where you're seeing organizations like ourselves and Rock the Recovery really making a difference. But opioid addiction definitely is the hot topic, but there is every other, you know, form of addiction too is still currently a big issue.
Okay, perfect. Thanks so much, Wes. You still? I know you're
Wes's Wes's internet has died, so I'll since I'm his doctor, I'll take his question for him. So, Rob, thank you for those questions. And you know, we
and
are
Constance, when you're done, can we yes and, because I feel like there's others.
I took your email, Cheryl.
Oh, terrific. Thank you.
Yeah. So to piggyback on what Kevin was saying, we're seeing a tremendous uptick in methamphetamine use again, particularly in areas where it didn't go down. You're seeing that in the Rust Belt. You're seeing that in Oregon. You're seeing that in a lot of places. We also are seeing a tremendous increase in substance abuse. In alcohol abuse. I used to get, and that really is related to quarantines and COVID lockdowns. I used to get 3 calls, emails a month. I get 27 or 28 now since lockdown. We're seeing a massive spike. We're seeing a massive spike also in relapses in the sober community. And we believe we're seeing an increase in overdose deaths, but we will not have those statistics until COVID is resolved. With regard to the military, the brain works how the brain works. And so we've gotten wonderful information from addiction treatment that now applies to the military. We work, Rock to Recovery works with the Air Force Wounded Warrior Program, AFW2, if you want to look it up online. And as part of their resiliency program, we would love to be involved with the other branches of the military. Right before lockdown in January, we had our first event with the Navy.
the other branches of the military are, they just structure their funding differently. And so the Air Force can pay for us. And so they pay for us to go to their care events and do these week-long events, not only with the warrior, but also with their caregivers. And I saw a comment in the chat about caregiver fatigue. It's extremely important. Heron Project has a wonderful aspect that works with that Kevin spoke to. So we work with those caregivers as well, because if the family unit doesn't get better, there are three options. Number one is the individual gets some treatment, the family gets no treatment, and so the individual relapses in order to fit in with the family. Option two is the individual gets treatment, the family gets treatment, and the whole system evolves together so that everybody experiences third option that we have is that the individual gets treatment, the family doesn't get treatment, and in order to stay in recovery, the individual leaves the family. Those are really the three options that we have. And so we really like the Heron Project, to work with individuals and their families together. So what we would need in to provide these services to other branches of the military is, of course, an introduction, but also for them to look at their funding so that we can move those services over or have resources that provide funding for us to do that. The other place where we would love to work is with active duty military, particularly when people come back from deployment, because where we see the big disconnect is people come back from deployment, they know what to say to not get tagged with a PTSD label so that they can go home and not to the hospital. And so if there were actual re-entry programs, which they're supposed to be there, they just aren't implemented. If we had true re-entry programs, then we could work with those individuals coming back. The thing about addiction treatment is we've always said, oh, you have to hit bottom. That is not true. If we can intervene at an earlier stage before a person is desperately ill, right? If we can work with youth while they're developing the propensity toward addiction, rather than after they are absolutely, you know, their liver is falling out like mine was, right? Then we can have a real good opportunity to change. But that requires multiple stages of intervention. So that requires funding youth programs, right? Which both Rock to Recovery and the Heron Project has. That requires funding those reintegration programs for the military and looking for, and your frontline people like us know where those soft points are, where those target points are. And so we can come in and say, oh, if this is the population you want to work with, here's where we insert ourselves. Here's where we insert ourselves. And with the military, that's really reentry. And that's really with the resiliency programming for people with PTSD.
Thanks so much.
MJ, if I could say one thing.
MJ.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Whoever wants to jump in first.
Jerry Connolly, Rob, thank you so much for pointing that out. And Constance, you did a great job in sort of analyzing what's going on in the military. I don't have a clinical answer here, but just from the various charities that I'm involved in and the outreach programs, I think the biggest thing for the military people is when they come back is to fit in. They need to feel, they all of a sudden, even though they did amazing things and their people are calling them heroes, they sit there and go, now what do I do? Because they just think this new world they're entering into is so much different from where they came from. So a lot of the programs that are really successful are putting a holistic approach to basically teach them how to teach her or him how to fish again, if you will, in a whole new area, teaching them skill sets, educating them, helping them move from the military to civilian life, and working on their strengths and their weaknesses to sort of get them into a role where they feel that they have self-worth again, and then they can provide for their family or themselves. Those are the programs that I think are really good. They're very helpful. The other thing that's really neat that's going on is a lot of the successful people that have gotten out of the military and done well are putting together charities and groups to help the individuals that are struggling. But the whole key is, I think Constance brought it up really beautifully, but it's that moment when they get out of the military and they put their uniform down. That's the approach where they could get very dark very quickly. And there's a lot of outreach going on. I've seen a lot of success. We got a long way to go, but it's motivating people. It's a big brother and sisterhood that is looking out after all these people and just checking in on them and making sure they're part of some sort of program or group that can basically help them and be supportive.
Thanks so much, Jerry. I want to be cognizant of time for Mark. I know there's people that want to ask questions. So Mark, I defer to you.
Good, keep going.
Cheryl.
Hi, thank you, Mark, for inviting me, and I'm so thrilled to be a part of this plan. I've worked in addiction. I've worked in early intervention with neuropsych from early education, and I've been working with the Air Force Airmen on a well-being and wellness for their families. And so I'd love to talk about, like, early intervention, and I just want to address that. I have my KDAC. I've been a part of rewriting the California State education plan, and there's a dual diagnosis thing that goes on that I'd like to address, and just as a touch point at this moment, but it's how to reach the individual users. And Cisco gave us money to create a what would be a user interface, and the reason why I'm bringing it up is because we targeted 18 plus, okay, 18 to 27 is where, like, our sweet spot was. And what you were talking about, shame and blame and, like, who's proactive? If there's some early intervention, whether it was while they were a teen, their parents were controlling the situation, they didn't have permission. So when you're asking a teenager to be of service to themselves, they don't have enough tools yet for, like, self-reflection and being proactive. Are you with me? I'm trying to talk fast in the understanding of limited time.
Yeah.
Okay. But so what I loved with using that was at 18, you are legally, you have to make the decision yourself. So we were like, okay, let's create this user interface world that looked like the underground, because feelings are the underground. So it looked like a very cool subway system. We took an image, we created an imagery what is that? You have to sign up for a Metro card. Every kid understands that. So with that kind of first vending machine, it was with your HIPAA compliance and your information, just like you sign up when you go to university. It could be a part of the university system or college. They know you have to fill out forms, so it's all integrated in there. And then there was a vending machine that we created that had all kinds of choices in it. And we used some, what, like, technically some people would have been considering inappropriate language, like, you know, shit to consider, right? So you go in the vending machine and there's shit to consider. I'm giving you examples because I didn't know about this until like 20 minutes ago and I was very excited to get on. But in shit to consider, there's like different post-its of articles, hotlines. You know, I'm very close to and have worked for many years with Teen Line. So, like, understanding even from Teen Line to different suicide prevention hotlines, articles, music, meditations. Then there are trains that were AR experiences that had an ensemble of friends. And I'm not going into my background too much, but used psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, kids themselves who have been through circumstances, and comedy writers from television to create a version of a problem that there would be kids on different trains dealing with rage, you know, mood disorder, all kind, being on the spectrum, anger, anxiety. And so there were different circumstances that there would be an ensemble of friends that were in your living room that would pop up in AR, right? And be life size. And they would start a scenario, break the fourth wall and ask you, do you ever feel this way? And then they were interactive and asking you questions and in real time. The next thing we had on this vending machine, I'm just giving you, and then would you need support?
I'm just trying to keep the village as a village.
Yeah.
One thing, and before some people have to break, I just want to answer your question, MJ, is like what we can do. Everybody's got their strength. I do these things, right? So, and if you see on the screen, there's some things in yellow. You know, we touch everything from people interested in Korean tribals to future of work. And the ones that I think in addition to the impact is, you know, this, we're doing this update on COVID-19 and how, what's up with the vaccine, what's up with behavior, what's up with data on infections, but maybe we should also have an addictions. And what we also do in most of our events is we do breakouts. This is sort of a general group, but we could do a larger group and that could be one of the breakouts. We are launching this philanthropy. So this touches on some of philanthropic piece, you know, ancillary pieces. And so I think you can pick it up there. These are all to be scheduled. There's also a sports media impact, you know, not just on the addiction side, but, you know, broadly. And there's obviously, they want to do good. I think sometimes with the stigma is they might come in because they want to do good. And then they realize you guys can help them on the addiction side. And Charles Way, who was the head of NFL player development, as you remember, some people off the fields where the NFL has to spend a lot of time, not only to protect their assets, but, you know, otherwise. And then I think I just added this, you know, maybe it's like a mental health summit. It's not a 60, 90 minute. Thing here. And then we can really, you know, have breakouts and then do what we normally do, which is with these 1-2 day conferences, we have a town hall. It's a breakout, try to address the subject and then people come together. And I like the idea of action plan. So that's my current thinking and then welcome others.
Anybody else jump? I think that's a fantastic idea with regard to mental health, because it's so hard to cover something like this in 90 days, let alone 90 minutes. So,
and Joe Azaro,
you're
my point person on this, because this is what you're passionate about. Do you want to chime in there?
No, I think that's a great idea. I know Sarah's been trying to comment in for 10 minutes. So please, Sarah, go ahead.
Sarah's been very patient.
I know it. Hasn't Sarah been patient? I just want to say two things. I worked at West Ed, helped put together the Healthy Kids Survey that's given in schools, in elementary, middle, and high schools. And I just want people to know that we have to get to our kids before 18. There's a lot of stuff going on. So I want to put that out there. And I worked with the feds also in putting together their survey. I also do research in resilience. Everybody on this pretty much knows this. Research, compassion fatigue, vicarious trauma. This is huge in this field as well. And I've done work with military. So I just want to put it out there if people don't know that from the chat.
Yeah, and Mark, what I would say is, like, listen, obviously this is a great starting point, but clearly we're kind of figuring out who cares about this, who's passionate. I want to really thank everybody for kind of making the time to, you know, participate in this. It's an incredibly important topic, and just seeing all your faces and everyone, kind of how engaged everybody is and the kind of chats, and, you know, it's super important. And so let's keep the conversation alive. Mark, if you've got, yeah, some kind of discussion group, I don't know if everybody's heard, but we have an app. And through that app, we can kind of continue. How many beers do I get for this one? I just want a tea. Mark, we have an app, and it's a great way to kind of continue conversations around these topics. And I think it would be really valuable for us to kind of.
I just created a mental health group on the app, as you can sort of see. Well, you can't see. And, you know, it's easy to join. You just hit that link. And, you know, it's like our mini Facebook with no advertising, or LinkedIn. It's a private community. You know, in fact, I can show it to you here. You know, it's where we can sort of, you know, we have like 350, 400 people on it. You can message people or you can turn people on or off. You know, just as we collaborate, you can see. You can visit the groups. So let's say mental health, it was just set up, and you can join the group. This one's open. So I want to join the group. It'll say bio. All you have to do is put a period and you're in, and you can have your own chats and members and all the rest.
And
it'd also be good to look at their people's bios to get an understanding of what their particular interests, are, investments are, stuff like that. So, similar to kind of like a LinkedIn, so you can kind of get a little bit of a download of who they are and what they're doing.
Yeah. I mean, so for example, you can see MJ, his posts, his activity, his background. What we are doing, this literally is just happening. It's part of this other initiative, which is your issues that you care about. Because when you submit, you go through our survey. Actually, I'll throw this in the chat, because it's all interconnected here. This is just launched today. It's trying to help people connect not only on deals, but where they're, I'll show you what we showed earlier today, which was right here. Yeah. So, this is how we can connect. We have the survey and we're also just trying to, this was part of that poll we did earlier today. So that people can self-identify where their issues are. I've seen people really random. I've seen an oil and gas guy get along with Cheryl in Phoenix. And I've seen people can interconnect in different ways. And we have, if some people who are new to us, but we're all about interconnecting. So I did alumni work, first go to college in Ohio. and I'd love to interconnect alumni, and now I was with the Family Office Investing, so we have you connect where are you an ag guy, so you go to the ag group, but if what we're really trying to do is bring our groups all together, to interconnect on different issues, and then people come in through wherever they come. This has been beautiful to open my eyes on all this stuff, so I am excited to have thought leaders like many of you here to be part of this community. And I don't know if that's my 4-year-old opening my door or my 15-year-old, but I'll stop there. But you guys carry on. Just that's how I think that I can be helpful.
So I just wanted to, if there's any other questions, please let me know. Outside of that, I wanted to thank everybody for kind of opening up their ears and their eyes to what Heron's doing, to what Apex Wellness is doing, to what Rock to Recovery is doing, to what Lucid's doing. It's a big challenge that's going on. And I think that it's worthy of a much deeper dive. So Mark, I appreciate kind of like looking to extend this whole topic of mental health. Listen, we're in the middle of this crazy situation with COVID right now, and mental health needs to kind of be on the forefront. So anyway, I just wanted to thank Mark and Joe and 361, as well as Nash and Wes and Dr. Scharf and Kevin, awesome. And all of you.
Thanks, everyone.
All right. Any questions?
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Thanks Very for good. Having us, guys.
All right. Yeah, have a great you. Day.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.